a young country, New Zealand has had more than its share of trouble throughout its brief but tumultuous history. Much of the upheaval has come from the restless earth. We've long been at the mercy of floods, volcanoes and freak typhoons, but as we'll see, the impact of our natural disasters often pales in comparison to the fallout from disasters of our own making. It's hard to believe that this peaceful suburb in Dunedin's Ruibin Fringe was once the scene of devastating devastation. Abbotsford simply slid away in what has been described as our worst peacetime landslide.
The slip, or most of it, actually occurred on the other side of those trees in an area where there's been a nudist colony.
The Abbotsford landslide left an insurance bill in the millions, but the destruction cost a lot less than the fallout from a man-made catastrophe that happened 1,312 k's north of here. In 1999, TVNZ decided to lure John Hawkesby back to state TV.
Good evening.
Hello and welcome to Top Half.
I'm John Hawkesby.
And I'm Judy Bailey.
Hawkesby and Bailey were considered broadcasting royalty. TVNZ thought that repairing them would be a ratings winner, but viewers resented the sacking of Richard Long and the ratings took a nosedive. It was a rough ride for Hawkesby.
Late this afternoon, a body was removed.
Then TVNZ sacked his ass and Hawkesby called in his lawyer, who turned out to be pretty useful. In the end, TVNZ were ordered to pay him $5.2 million.
Thank you very much indeed.
Great New Zealand television, that's what it's about.
The idea to bring Hawkesby to TVNZ has been attributed to one of the most colourful characters in our broadcasting history, a man who was himself no stranger to trouble. The late, great Neil Roberts was a brilliant reporter, a bombastic producer, and a sports car driving bad boy of the highest order.
When you share the road with him, this is the angle you usually see.
The ex-Prime Minister is Sir Robert Muldoon.
He even had his own Letterman-style TV show.
Well, thank you.
Tell me, how much do you miss the hurly-burly of being in the top job?
Oh, I've still got a lot of hurly and a bit of burly.
Roberts was never out of the news with his fast cars, marriages and speeding tickets. He even bought a pair of MiG fighters. There's little doubt that the shenanigans of Neil Roberts would have taken up some space inside here, home of the Whanganui police computer. But any record of his indiscretions might not have existed if another man, also called Neil Roberts, had succeeded in his plan. The Whanganui computer struck fear into the heart of young New Zealand. It was Big Brother in action, a supercomputer that tracked our every move.
Now, everything that is going to be put into this computer centre is already held in manual forms by the different departments that are in it. That's justice, transport and police.
For 22-year-old Neil Roberts, it simply had to go. And so, armed with explosives, he set off towards the computer, stopping on the way to leave one last piece of graffiti. As Roberts approached the building, the gelignite ignited and the prophecy tattooed on his chest, "This young punk won't live to see 23," came true. The explosion was devastating for Roberts and for the man who found him.
I go to bed at night thinking of nothing else but seeing Neil Roberts walk up to the front door. I see him, as clear as a bell, I see him bend over, I see the bang.
A friend of Roberts later told the media that the Whanganui computer wasn't the only target that Neil had considered bombing.
Did he talk to you about the way in which he might commit suicide?
Well, we discussed several ways of committing suicide. I think the Whanganui Computer Centre, that was one that we talked about the most.
Did you talk about any others?
Yes, the beehive.
Was he going to blow up the beehive? Did you talk about blowing up the beehive?
Yeah, we talked about it. Like, if he's going to kill himself, he might as well... The idea was to take something with him that was annoying everybody.
The computer was unharmed and was recently decommissioned and scuttled at Metauri Bay, where it will form a reef for divers. But Neil Roberts wasn't the only Kiwi who was worried about Big Brother. A year earlier, Tanya Harris led her own protest against the perceived threat of communism in the guise of unionism.
We've had enough.
We've had enough.
This is the first time that New Zealanders like ourselves have got together and done something about these commies.
I'm fed up with being bossed.
We've got to keep New Zealand green.
And I don't want New Zealand to become like England on its knees to the workers.
Because I'm just sick of the whole business and what it's doing to New Zealand.
In a nutshell, it was a protest against protest, a strike against strikes. But Tanya wasn't the only great female troublemaker of the last millennium. Amy Bock was a con artist and compulsive liar par excellence. Her criminal career reached its peak in 1909 when, calling herself Percy Redwood, she was discovered impersonating a man on the eve of her honeymoon in South Otago. But this was no civil union. Towards the end of the 20th century, there was more female trouble, and this time it was double trouble. In 1997, two sisters from Nelson would rise to national prominence. They were known as the Ingham twins, and their journey into New Zealand folklore would begin in a place much like this. The Inghams stowed away on a Malaysian container vessel, jumping ship in Australia with a crew member who'd fallen in love with them.
The only English she apparently spoke to the police was, "This is true love. This is true love. I love them both."
It was an act of madness so extreme that many thought they were bullshitting.
The amount of tiger sharks and the size of the tiger sharks that are in them particular waters, you know, some of the fish there are, you know, well over 1,000 pounds. I mean, and they love nothing better than to eat something that's just floundering around on top of the water.
These are the Ingham twins, Sarah Ingham and Joanne Ingham.
Their troublemaking continued and the Inghams became celebrities, partly due to their economical use of language which gave them a zen-like gravitas.
And you got on what, yesterday?
Yeah.
I see. So how's everyone, Mum and Dad?
They're fine.
Okay. Enjoying Auckland?
Yeah, it's all right.
The pair were the tabloid toast of the town, and they became so popular that for a short time in the 90s, they replaced Edmund Hillary on the $5 note. We've learned much about the devastating effects that Pākehā had on Māori, but sometimes the booty was on the other foot.
The Māoris, quickly get the child here.
This is actual footage of an attack on innocent Pākehā. Of all the Māori troublemakers, Hongi Hika is the most celebrated. He was a sort of super chief, a charismatic cannibal who travelled to England in 1820, where he entertained royalty. The story was the subject of an animated film from 1923, which was recently uncovered by the Film Archive.
Thank you.
These days, any chimp can get his hands on a gun, but back in Hongi Hika's day, serious weaponry was very hard to come by. So when Hongi returned from London, he brought with him some very special duty-free. A few hundred of these. Years later, other troublemakers would also import weapons from abroad. Like Hongi Hika, Red Squad chieftain Ross Morant sourced his weapons offshore. His American-made PR-24 baton, known as a Minto Bar, recently sold to a South African collector for $20,000. These days, the pigs are meant to be impartial, but back in 1981, things were very different.
Ross Morant describes the socialising and drinking sessions which the squad shared with the Springbok team, often at private functions organised by the Red Squad. His opinion of the Springboks is high.
Real nice guys. Pretty quiet bunch. Their manners amazed me. They are always well-mannered. Here's some tales about touring team and women. But that women most certainly weren't a preoccupation with them.
The Springboks of 81 were the first touring rugby team to include practicing homosexuals. Of the 30-man squad, seven were fully gay, three were tops, and four were bottoms. Nowadays, gay rugby players are common and even encouraged, but back in the 1980s, there was still massive public resistance to gay players who were considered to be unhygienic.
What gets forgotten is that the anger wasn't just directed at the apartheid issue. There was also a large anti-gay element to the protest.
Sadly, there was no Red Squad on hand when Robin Gibb visited us for the Redwood Festival in 1970. He arrived in a security van, but there was trouble brewing that would soon erupt into an eruption.
I've got to remind you, the police and the security service have promised to remove anybody from the grounds who creates any sort of disturbance at all. Now, Robin Gibb will be on stage, on schedule, and if there's any trouble at all, Gibb's act will stop. So let's cool it and have a groovy scene.
The BG played at the end of a long, hot day. And being New Zealanders, and more specifically West Aucklanders, the crowd were wasted as. It was a recipe for a shocking display of disorderly conduct. First came the projectiles. Then a wanton Westie wench rushed the stage and tried to pash Gibb with her tongue. Then her Mongi brother had a crack at the pop idol. Luckily, promoter Phil Warren was on hand to reassure Gibb and to convince him to return to the stage the very next day.
Yeah, well,
and let's face it, the thing's been blown out of all proportion, because
yeah,
what
right.
was there on stage? 10 cans, 2 bottles, and a half a dozen tomatoes. That's virtually what...
Smorgasbord.
A smorgasbord.
But the joke was on me.
Teeth like these are rarely seen today. Modern celebrities are more likely to have a set of gnashes like these glossy white choppers found on this Angus bull. Rich in semen, this handsome Welsh stud fathered an estimated 40,000 fillet steaks after it was introduced to New Zealand at the quarantine station on Soames Island. Our warm welcome extended to a loving comb and shampoo, but not so other beasts incarcerated on the island. Soames Island and Wellington Harbour, bleak, repulsive, a fatal shore. It was here in the First and Second World Wars that we rounded up immigrant krauts and wops and imprisoned them. They were considered dangerous. They were classified as enemy aliens. They sublimated their quite possibly evil lusts for world domination by making ornate jewellery boxes like these with typical German efficiency.
With all the time in the world to spend, everyone could display his ingenuity.
But in 1943, three Fritzes escaped the island after they were humiliatingly forced to parade in their underwear. They built a raft and made it to Petone and for many years hid out in Inglewood, making more jewellery boxes, unaware the war was over. But one man never left his captivity at the foot of Soames Island on Leper Island.
a name recalling the time when a Chinaman from Petone, stricken with a dread disease, was banished here to spend the rest of his days.
Wellington fruiterer Kim Lee was suspected of having leprosy and was dumped in this cave on what became known as Leper Island.
He dragged out his time entirely alone, with only this cave to protect him from the weather.
He died after 9 lonely months. We now know he probably didn't have leprosy at all, that he had TB or just bad skin. The illness was ours. New Zealand has long treated the Chinese as social lepers.
The thing that tends to break down hostility to another race, in any country, anywhere in the world, is the kids get to know one another. Because the poll tax meant that, in many cases, many of these first Chinese settlers here couldn't bring their families, they didn't have kids who were helping to develop that process. I suspect that's got a little bit to do with it.
Just a year after Kim Lee's death on Leper Island, another Chinese man, Joe Kum Yung, was killed in a racist attack. Lionel Terry was an oddball Englishman whose obsession with the yellow peril led him to murder. It was here in Wellington's Haining Street that Lionel Terry shot the harmless elderly man whom he'd never even met. He then went to the pub where he auctioned off his trademark cane and turned himself into the police. He told them he killed Mr. Yung to draw attention to the yellow peril. Terry was sent here to Seacliff Hospital, just north of Dunedin, where he spent the last 30 years of his life lecturing staff and patients and climbing hills around here, often with nurses in his wake, keen to make sure he didn't escape. The devil, it said, makes work for idle hands. Kids these days keep themselves busy with all manner of distractions, but back in the 60s, boredom was one of this country's biggest problems. It's also the root of one of our most troublesome issues, gangs.
Well, we're all in a gang, and I'm in a gang because I like these fellas' company, and we all like going around together. We've got nothing to do here, so we just stick together.
You're bored?
Yeah.
What is there to do here?
There's nothing. Nothing.
Many of our best gangs were born out of disaffection with the Pākehā system. They took their names from Shakespeare. The mongrel mob, black power, headhunters, Mormons and stormtroopers.
People said, if you go near the gangs, they'll do you over. You know, yeah. They'll beat you up. We were told that, and they'd break the cameras.
Did you get scared?
Well, we got scared.
No,
would you be scared?
Well,
you wouldn't do that.
Now?
No.
Oh, well. We're not troublemakers. We don't go looking for anything, but if anyone wants to step us out, then we'll finish it.
Although less visible and far less threatening, the Pākehā had their own gangs, but they were far more mobile than their brown-skinned brothers. The Hell's Angels were white trash in excelsis, and this documentary made in 1972 has until now never been shown. It was considered not to be in the public interest.
Because we're Hell's Angels. That's why, mate. Because we're Hell's Angels, mate.
Well, I look at it. Some people join the army, some people join the Salvation Army, some people join bowling clubs, some people join tennis clubs, I join the Hell's Angels.
People, you know, they sneer at you and you have the odd blue and all that. Well, that's fair enough. You know, all the blokes that have got a patch are going to get a patch, are going to back you to the limit.
I think they're diminishing. It'll be interesting. The police always used to publish numbers. We don't hear so much about them now. Now and again, some of them murder one another. That's excellent. And I don't know why the police don't encourage it, you know.
Well, it's true that the gangs were involved in all manner of illegal activity, including the sale of illicit drugs. Cheer, bro. They were also pioneers of other far more positive enterprises. The mongrel mob opened our first ever wellness centres and even offered an early form of aromatherapy with a fully equipped Pilates studio in Hastings. The Black Power countered with a highly profitable string of vegetarian restaurants. Sadly, the stormtroopers misjudged the tech boom, opening a string of internet cafes well before the arrival of broadband. The internet cafes may have been a financial disaster, but thanks to some canny investments in a certain company called Microsoft, the gang made enough money to fund their own America's Cup challenge. So, despite their bad reputation, by the 1990s, the gangs had gone from being troublemakers to tribute makers. When the great white troublemaker, Sir Robert Muldoon, finally relinquished his portfolio in 1992, it was the Black Power who provided the most memorable memorial. While it's easy to blame Maori for most of our trouble, it's now clear that the Pākehā, the Asians and the Dutch have also added plenty of palaver to the pavlova of New Zealand history. Like immigration, the treaty and gonorrhea, trouble will always be with us and will continue to define this country, our Aotearoa, land of trouble.
This show was made with funding from New Zealand On Air.